Welcome to the Live Around Show, and we're here for the next 2 hours tonight. And of course, with me tonight, as normal, is Keith Mum.
Evening, Dave.
And of course, also with me as well is Glenn Paul.
Evening, Dave.
And then, of course, we've got everybody in from Dinner Ricky. So we've got Glenn, we've got Billy, we've got Paul, and of course, we've got Justin as well back with us again for a second time this time now.
Yep.
So welcome, guys, and nice to have you in the studio, and hope it carries on for you, playoffs.
Yep, good evening, yeah.
Well, start off then with the Ryman Prems, because we always start off to see what we think of the scores during the week. So, funny enough, yours is first up. Billericay 4, Burgess Hill Town 0.
Good result for the lads, isn't it? They're sitting here. they can tell us about the result, but the game that obviously sticks out is the goals in quick succession. So, killed them off, really, 0-0. But talk us through the game, gents.
Well, I'll start. Basically, the first half, we should have been 3-4-0 up. They was bouncing off the line, it was bouncing off the bar, it was bouncing off the post. So by the time we went in at half-time, we knew we didn't really have to change much, really. But we did have to put the ball in the net, for sure. So we did make a couple of changes. We changed the two wide players. But really, we just had to keep doing what we was doing. I'll let someone else finish.
829, please.
Yeah.
I think that was the best result of the day, to be fair.
That was the best result of the day, yeah. I mean, when
better than the 3 points, Justin.
Well, I'm just the crash almost quadrupled.
Yeah, it's excellent.
You know, and you're talking about the long-term project. No, that's got to be the way forward, getting the crowd through the doors, but it won't.
Well, when I took over, there was an average crowd of 280 4 months ago. So to get it to 800 and something in 4 months, brilliant. That's pretty special. Mm-hmm. That's pretty special.
Do you think that's people like Paul coming in?
Of course, Paul makes a difference. Of course he does, yeah. He makes a big difference. I think it's a mixture of everything. It's a mixture of all of a sudden we're having the Colts part of the club. So they're going out and they're going out as mascots. Mm. We've got people like Paul joining us. We're getting results now. Mm. Got a very good manager. but jokes aside, I think it's a mixture of everything. I think everything's happening at the same time, and the fans are backing us, and that's great. That's really good.
Yeah.
Cavi Island 3, Grays Athletic 1, 386 there.
It's a great result for Canvey, isn't it? It was a big battle, that one. We've said over the last few weeks that Canvey have
themselves out,
pulled them out of it now, haven't they? And you want a club like Canvey to stay in the league, really. You don't want them to drop down. Well, we definitely don't. I just think it's a great result, and it kills Grays off, really, doesn't it, unfortunately. Yeah. But they'll come back next year.
Won it up as well, they went as well in that game as well, in 29. 386, that one. Dulwich Hamlet 5, Mersham 0, 1,564.
Surprise, I thought the game would be bigger. that's a great result for Dulwich. I know they should beat Mersham, but they both try and play football very similar. And
must have been a good game to watch.
And I think maybe that's where Mersham could have kind of stuck. If they've gone at Dulwich, Dulwich would have just picked them off maybe, and they've got a bit of quality and they can finish. That's it.
Folkestone Victor 1, Wingate and Finchley 0, 347.
I was surprised at that, personally. Wingate have been on a good run. Spoke to their chairman in the week, we're good friends, and he fancied them to make the playoffs. Not pressure-wise, just because of the way they're playing football. They ain't got the pressure to make it, but he does fancy them. I hope, obviously, for our sake, that all the teams slip up above us. But, I'm surprised.
Nice club. You're right, I know Aaron well. He's been tweeting quite a lot recently, isn't he, about his football. But they've done excellent. They had a great result in the week as well, didn't they? Mm. So they would expect to have gone there and won, because folks have been struggling.
Yeah, like you said, Dave, it's a difficult place to go, isn't it? So, good result for them.
Harrowborough 2, Worthing 2, 194.
Yeah. Again, Harrow's a difficult place to go. I've just seen the two goal scorers again. Charles Smith scored, and Worthing, they needed a point because they've gone on a bit of a slippery run, haven't they? So that's all right with them.
Havant Waterlooville 6, AFC Sudbury 0, 695 there.
They're struggling, Sudbury, aren't they? On a bit of a... They could be one drop in it, yeah.
Again, but Roman North clubs won't want them to come down.
Mm. No, because the AstroTurf as well. But the Geezer's got 4 goals as well, don't
they? Yeah. Yeah, so they've got 3, yeah.
At what, gents, have you played, haven't yet?
Yeah, we got a result. We beat them
2-1.
Yeah,
we
got a result then.
Yeah, because everyone we spoke to recently think that they're going to win it.
Not a bad side. They've got some good players there.
They've got a couple of lads from Dogner last year, didn't they? And Rutherford and obviously Pryor. But
now, what can you put your finger on with Sudbury though? Because I mean, Sudbury at the beginning of the season, we said to me, I think halfway through, we said it's always one side that's always up around that sort of playoffs, 9th, 10th, and all of a sudden goes on a really bad run and just sort of nosedives really quickly. And this time around, it seems to be Sudbury that's done it.
We said before, it might sound silly to pull on that, but this league's tough. And when you're on a bit of a slide and confidence is low, the teams at this level will beat you. And if you don't take your chances, as you were saying earlier, they'll go at the other end and score. And to be fair, go away down to Avant, it's tough. And Sudbury need to show a bit of fighting quality now, maybe.
They've got a lot of goals as well. They've got big four, didn't they, the other night as well.
So. Yeah, you know, their pitch with the AstroTurf lets people play on it as well. I know, you know, if there's a lot of footballing teams out there, they're going to go to Sudbury and be able to play.
So, and it's one of the best 4Gs.
You know, it's not
G's
bad. So that's it. Whereas maybe they can't shut up shop and go and kick a few people and get a 0-0 away from home. When you're fighting for your life, that's what you need. And that's maybe where they may come unstuck.
Leatherhead 3, Hendon 2. What a great result for Jimmy.
Yeah, no, he needed that. He definitely needed that. Because they, you know, that's gave him a little bit of hope.
And 2-0 down.
Yeah.
So I know Alfie was tweeting about all the comebacks that they've been over the weekend, and that was the one that he said everybody seemed to miss out, but from 283, don't you? Leiston 1, Bognor 1, probably the game of the day, would you say?
Yeah, it's a shock though, because as we just said, Leiston have been struggling. You know, they've got themselves in a great position, and then they've had a bit of a wobble up, so that's a good result for them, and I think Bognor, I think that's 2 points dropped. Mm.
Lowestoft Town 1, Kingstonian 0, 502.
I spat Tommy. Tommy, I know you won't like me saying this because the lads are sitting here, but Tommy rung me in the week and he said they're struggling a little bit for confidence, and he spoke to me about a player and so on, and it's a shame because he's a big club, Kingstonian.
When we spoke before about it, they were right on the brink of the playoffs, and I don't think they've won since.
No.
That's about 6-7 weeks ago.
Met Police 0, Harlow Town 2, 91.
That's a good result, Harlow, because Met Police have been on a little bit of form recently.
Mm-hmm. Right. The difference,
that's
though,
a big crowd for Met Police.
But we were saying
he's over there.
They're probably 9-0 or higher. 9-0.
Over there. That's
a joke. We get about 4 or 5 people sometimes.
Because people don't want to go and watch the police. You can't. Well, I'm well surprised because you can't drink and drive, and now you can't text and go over there.
You look at that though, we've got police. You look at that, we've met police, 91 go in there, and you know they're up against the big hitters in the league, you know, yourselves and the Dulwiches, and there's a lot of big hitters in that league, and you look at that 91 and think, how do they stay in there year in, year out with that type of crowd?
I've spoken about that before though, their budget, and I'm not talking about terms, it's set every year because of the police and what they pay into it, so you know, they don't need a club. But the downside with the crowds are, and they know, is that it's a lovely ground. Mm-hmm. It's a decent setup. The pitch is lovely. They've got everything, you know. And but it is also where it is a bit of the ghetto. Mm-hmm.
Well, it's probably the surprise of the day in this league, I would have thought. Needham Market 1, Enfield Town 3.
It's a shock because Needham are going well. And again, before I said it's up there, but Enfield keep getting 2 great results and then losing one, and they get towards the playoffs and then just
they're always out there. And then they just, like you said, they either make it and fall out or fall out before it. Good team though, Enfield.
Yeah, they are. A difficult team to beat, and they've got a lot going forward as well.
Staines 1, Tunbridge 1, 251.
I think that's a shock.
Yeah.
I think that's a bit of a shock. Tunbridge needed to win that.
Well, the table then, so it's Havant Waterlooville top now, but played 36 with 74 points. Bognor Regis have played 37 with 73. Needham Market have played 39 with 67. Tonbridge 39 with 64. And the last playoff place, Wingate and Finchley, 39 with 63. Then Leiston played 35 with 59. Dulwich have played 34 with 57. Enfield have played 39 with 57. Billericay have played 38 with 57. And Harlow have played 38 with 57. At the bottom, it's Grays Athletic played 39 with 32. Hendon 38 with 38. Leatherhead, 37 with 38. AFC Sudbury now in the bottom four, played 38 with 40. Mersham 34 with 41. Burgess Hill Town 36-42. And then Kingstonian, Harrow and Canvey Island on the rise all with 44. Mm. So where do we see now then? I mean, well, so we ask every week and it changes every week.
Guys, don't mention anyone get relegated, they might beat us.
We won't say about a result, well, we will do in a minute. looking at the top, obviously, haven't got the game in hand, so I fancy them. And it's just asking these lads, for the playoffs, it's down to Harlow, I think, 57 and up. So,
you think Lowestoft out of it completely?
Yeah. They're just too inconsistent, and they keep saying they ain't got enough money. Everyone with crowds of 500 average. They want to try and get 36 through the game. who do you think that, obviously, I know you keep doing your team, you've got about the playoffs, but whose place do you think you could pop in there? It's quite tight.
Well, it's Tunbridge and Wingate we're going
for. Yeah, it's fourth and fifth. We're looking to nick 64 points, 63 points. Mm. They're the ones I think we can nick.
But does the situation, although they've got sort of 64, 63, are you concerned still about the likes of Leeston and Dulwich that are sitting there with games in hand?
Well, I was very, very concerned about Dulwich 3 weeks ago. Leeston 3 weeks ago. Very concerned, but they've gone on a run, which isn't doing them any favours. Dulwich, we're playing them on the Tuesday, we're playing them on the Saturday. So our destiny's in our hands.
Is that the same week?
Same week, Tuesday and Saturday. We have Dulwich Tuesday, Dulwich Saturday. We have Dulwich Saturday, Dulwich Tuesday, Leeston Saturday. Yeah. So we've got them three. That week we will know where we're at with the playoffs.
And in my eyes, if you win those three,
we win them three, at least at home. Dulwich away on the Saturday, Dulwich at home on the Tuesday, Leeston at home.
Leeston's fixtures to coming in, obviously, are Harlow, Folkestone, Worthing, Bognor, Billericay, Mersham, Leverhead, Harrowborough, Kingstonian.
There you go, not easy.
Lowestoft, Enfield. Whereas four games there, you might think they'd after they've finished with yourselves, they've got a few hard ones before you, though.
Mm. Yeah.
So you're right. It's
they always fun. Seem to do this, though, don't they?
They do. But with them this year, they seem to pick up their good results against the top sides. Mm. It's the ones just below they seem to be struggling with at the moment.
And they're playing a couple of teams that are fighting for their lives as well.
Yeah, they are. Mm. They are. Then Enfield last game.
That's right, we're below them, so we might win on Saturday.
Nah.
Bottom plan, the Grays Athletic, Hendon, Leatherhead, Sudbury are the four that are in there. But then it's after that, it's quite tight. It goes probably right up as far as Folkestone and Victor. 45 points, or would you go Met Police 47?
No, I think Met Police have done enough. The result that's, I know they lost Saturday, but Jim's done a great job over there pulling them out of there when they were in the deep.
Incredible.
They're safe. I still think Harrowborough are as well, and the way Canvey are putting a little bit it's a lot, you know, when you're winning, I know it sounds like it's an old cliche, but it's easy to get points when you're losing and you're scrapping. Confidence is, shot pitch. Your players that are excellent just can't pass the ball.
Kingstone, if they don't pick up a result soon, they'll be in the dogfight big time. Because they're slipping.
They are. But he's got enough there for me. The front two are good enough for me. Mm. Centre half, he's a little bit wasted. He's saying he's conceding, but they've got enough players.
They've still got Andre McCullin, yeah?
No.
Oh, he's at Tunbridge, isn't he?
Mm. No, they've got DK and Mossy.
And of course, the likelihood this year as well, nothing's been spoken about so far that there might not be any reprieves either.
But it depends, doesn't it? I think there's rumours of a conference club struggling a little bit, isn't there? So you won't know until the old tax man comes out.
So Division 1 North then. Averley 2, Sandtown Rangers knew I was at that game and... I think someone could have been playing till now and they still wouldn't have scored. And that's probably been as fair as you can possibly be with them, because I thought, I said to you on this program a few times, I know where Brentwood, I thought they were absolutely woeful. Well, I hadn't seen Sam. Saw Sam at the weekend.
Is his league playing Sam? Dreadful.
Do you not like Sam?
No, I don't like Sam. No, I'm just saying, he's looking at this league game.
You got Sam next week?
We're in this league.
No, we're in this league.
Yeah, that's Sam.
No, I'm just saying. I just looked at his face. He's like, are you released?
Yeah. We'll start with some more then. Brentwood Town 3, Deer and
Town. He's definitely on a Brentwood.
76.
I love Brentwood. Well, that's
a night out.
That's a
night
out. That's a great result for them. They needed that big time, and That's a good result.
It's a, yeah, it's a bit weird with a manager situation, though, isn't it?
Yeah, yeah, it is. Tony left, going and
system comes in and the player goes back.
Yeah, but that was going to happen. That's happened twice this year.
Yeah, I know that the real truth of that. Like, it's not
your banner.
Not for air, though.
Oh, yeah.
I'm not hard to say everything on.
It's not fair, is it?
I mean, I watched them the other way, and they played quite well, actually. Yeah, 1-3-0 again, so I think...
And I heard Lamar missed a penalty as well to get a hat-trick. Yeah. Not
he scored a pen and all, though, didn't he? Two pens.
Yeah.
He couldn't do it, yeah, didn't
he? Apparently he missed the third.
Mm. Yeah.
Mm. Bury Town 2, Tilbury 1. Biggest crowd of the day. 281 in the North.
They've underachieved, Bury.
Not a bad side, though, on their day. They try and play. But that's not a shock, is it?
No. This one was, though. Chessant 3, Morden Tiptree 1, 182.
Why is it a shock?
Because
Chessant doing well.
I've had Chessant to win the league at the end of the season.
And it scored twice again, didn't he? They put Holland in there, but he did score twice, yeah. Mm. So they've had a little bit of a sort of revival.
I blame you. Since the Morden manager, have been in there, they've not. I think they've won one game.
No, but we come to that.
Great Way Creek Rovers 1, Witham Town 3.
Come Saturday night, guys. That's what I thought about.
This is why we're coming to that.
Great Way Creek Rovers 1, Witham 3.
That's no shock, is it? Great Way Creek, I think, struggled in there, haven't they?
125 there. One of the things, I did an interview with Nick Robinson on Saturday, and one of the things that the league is actually going to be bringing into the end of the season presentation is going to be Fan of the Year. Can you see past James?
No.
He'll win it every year.
Well, it ain't going to be one of mine.
You got
one. We only get about
for these guys that don't know. I think you should enlighten them about James.
James is probably the only fan Whitten have got, as he says, and he stands behind the back of the goal wherever he goes. He takes about 10, 12 flags with him, puts them up. And just literally, he's got every type of musical instrument you can be, screams his head off.
I've seen that.
Went to Averley at the weekend, speaking to Craig, and Craig said when they visited Averley, they had a complaint from one of the neighbours of the noise that was coming from the ground.
And it was one man.
One man. And he said he had to go back to the other half. There's only one bloke.
He travels to a train all the time.
Wroxham, everywhere from there, all by train.
I don't think he should bring that one back because he's going to win every year.
Yeah, as well. Not quite.
What's he going to get?
Find out.
Maybe a Ryman suit.
Heybridge Swifts 1, Haringey Borough 4.
Just kept them in it.
I don't know if you remember, James Robertson, Matt over at Whitham, I think before Christmas, said that Haringey Borough would get in the playoffs. Everyone looked at him like he was crazy. Mm. Even me. And I think that he's not far. They're not going to be far off.
Not going to be far off. I'm not sure.
I don't think they'll make it. They won't be far off.
No, done well. Done very well.
If a certain other team keep losing, then there's a chance. We'll move on to him in a minute. Perhaps Phoenix. Phoenix Sports 1, Bowers and Pixie 0.
It's a great result. This I was normally over there again yesterday all afternoon. Talking about football. Well, it's across the road from my ground. Oh, yeah, listen, they're the best over
there. To be fair, it's a nice little clubhouse.
Yeah, we always meet over there. And that's with 10 men as well. They beat them, and Anesh, who lost his dad, who's a good friend of mine, last week, got the winner in the last minute.
When did he get set up? How long was it?
Quite a while, I think. So, and Bowers obviously scored 5 in the last 2 games, so that's a big result for Phoenix and keeps the hope alive.
Thames Mead 2, VCD 2.
Travesty this game, I tell you. Tommy Wilde rang me today and said, don't go on the radio, and said, you should have been 6-0 up and whatever. So I won. No, we should have won comfortably.
No, you had a little magician in the middle of pitches.
Yeah, Rash played well, to be fair. He did play well, but we just signed Lance Jager as well, and he fitted in at the centre half, and he was solid as we looked really solid. But yeah, we should have been 5 up at half time. We missed 5 one-on-ones. If we'd have had Billy, I think he would have got 2 match balls and left it. We bought them off with 45 minutes to go. But to be fair, we didn't score, and we managed to nick one just after half time, and then took our foot off, and they had a 20-minute spell and scored two goals, and we come back. But it's a couple of drop points for us, unfortunately.
I see Alex Nola scored.
Yeah.
Good goal, wasn't it?
Yeah, for him it was a good goal. For Nicholas in goal, it was a poor mistake. He got done from an acute angle, 25 yards out, near post, that I would have saved.
Thurrock 0, Norwich United 1, Christy Finch 86.
Great result for Norwich. It's a big shock, but the lad up front can score goals, so he can tell you that.
Only shot on target there. That says it all. We was dreadful though. No two ways about it. All that work we did, obviously beating Brighton and seeing the week before, gone to waste now, unfortunately. They did exactly what we did, soaked up the pressure. It's football, isn't it? That's as simple as that. But yeah, no excuses, we was awful.
You played them?
That means you win your next game 4-0.
What's that then?
You win your next game 4-0 if Forms goes to...
I've got Soane. Well, I told you I'm not mentioning Soane.
Remember I said?
Yeah. No way. Yeah, bad result.
Waltham Abbey 0, Brighton Sea Region 3.
Well, with the other two teams losing.
And they put out all the big guns, didn't they? Kelly, Hunt, Condon and Richardson all playing.
Well, scored them the goals, didn't it? Yeah. And like I said, we went there the other week. Waltham Abbey ain't an easy place to go and play any sort of football.
Where nil, AFC Hornchurch 2.
Can't all have pictures like BCD's.
No, but it's not that bad. This is shocking. No, this was shocking. It wasn't down there. You've been there. It's just awful.
Where nil, AFC Hornchurch 2. 97.
Keeps what we said last week about Hornchurch. Their team that are equipped to go up, they're just chugging away, and Mackenzie scored again.
Brought in a couple of big players as well.
Were you surprised it was only two?
No, not really, because again, Ware's not an easy place to go. You've got to go on the slope, you've got everything. So, but they've just gone and done a proper job. 2-0.
Frank, that's what they're doing, isn't it? That's what they're doing.
Wroxham 1, Romford 2.
No, it's not shocking. Yeah. Wroxham.
So the Division North then, Wroxham is bottom, paid 38 with 23. Great Wakeham paid 39 with 24. Sandown Rangers are paid 39 with 36. Brentwood Town 38 with 37. Ware 39 with 39. Haybridge 38 with 42. Waltham Abbey 39 with 43. And at the top, Brighton in Sea Region 39 with 84. Morden and Tiptree have played 39 with 78. AFC Hornchurch have played 39 with 75. Thurrock have played 38 with 72. Chessington played 39 with 69. Haringey Borough played 39 with 68. Bowers and Pitsea have played 38 with 67.
Stop there. 6-point gap, by the way.
Yeah.
So who's going to Brighton Sea Region? I think 3 points it went back down to, back up now to 6.
That's good enough for me now, I think, this time.
I think there's one or two more turns.
Nah,
Brighton Sea, to be fair, probably the best team in the league.
7 games.
When they played Villarreal a couple of times, it weren't easy games. We beat them. But it weren't easy games.
A couple of big games coming up, but and we'll see.
Yeah, they've got Hornchurch, Haringey as well. But yeah, I mean,
everyone's got to win all their games, and they need to slip up twice.
It's a defining week for me. Well, obviously we lost. You see, Morden lost. And look, and they've won. So.
And also as well, Hornchurch now have been sort of distanced as well now to Morden. It's only 3 points now between them and them. So. It's going to get interesting. Is anybody going to sneak in that playoff? Morden, Hornchurch, Thurrock,
Chessington?
Bowers. What
so you think it's going to come out with Bowers on it?
Chessington.
No.
Chessington.
I just think you can't go apart.
When
you've got goal scorers of Jason Haggett, I just think you can't rule him out until they make that a bit, you know.
But I just think overall, Bowers have got more goals than him.
Probably all round, they probably Chesnut will have more Jason Hallett, but he's been there, done it, got the T-shirt.
So is David Knight.
Yeah, fair comment. Jason Hallett scores more than his.
Top drop.
Not sure. Not at the moment.
All right.
Who's top out of them two? I bet
him.
Who?
David Knight.
Is he?
Yeah.
Well, what?
I don't think so.
I think Knight has got more because Jason had a bit of a dry-up spell.
I think you'd be surprised if you look.
We'll have a look in a break and we'll find out. We'll let everybody know. Rama Division 1 South then. Chipstead 2, Sittingbourne 2. Front of 70 there. East Grinstead Town 4, Cray Wanderers 2.
What a result that is for East Grinstead.
Got no manager and they won 4-2. Good result.
109 there. This is the it's got to be the shock of the week, isn't it? It's got to be. Godalming Town 1, Lewis nil, if not the season. Wow.
Yeah, well.
So they won. Have they won?
Gordon Means about Paul because he's sitting there. Poor old Gordon Means have had 15 points
all season.
Gordon Means had 15 points. Well, they had nine.
No, they won.
They had 9 points about 6 weeks ago. Now they've got 18. And they were just, they've conceded 116 goals.
Yeah.
They've conceded 116 goals.
Wow. 15 points from safety.
So,
7 games to go.
And they've just beat the side at the length. Yeah. And on a good run. So it's a great result.
6 men as well. But great result. Greenwich Borough 0, Corinthian Casuals 3, 268.
Surprise for me.
It's a surprise, even though they're placed below them, Greenwich are flying and they had a great result in the week as well, smashing South Park. And as we had the lads in the other week, they didn't think, well, Andy Galsin couldn't see them losing another game.
Mm.
I think we learned that safety to do because we backfired.
But Corinthian Casuals, whenever they get, and they were the second team from the south nominated for Craig Johnson's team of the week. And if you nominate Corinthian Casuals in a set of four to vote for, 9 times out of 10, they're going to win it because of their Brazilian connections and stuff, and it just all comes all over. So they were winning the last time I looked, but we'll announce that up in second half.
That's got golden, isn't it?
Hastings United 0, Tooting the Mitcham United 1.
It's a good result.
645.
It's a good result for Tooting away from home. Hastings have got some decent players. Great crowd. I think that's enough for them.
Yeah, they've won it.
Horsham 0, Herne Bay 2. Will you say that? Go back to that. Their last two games are Carr, Shorten and Dorking.
Yep, might be on the bottom.
They might be.
Hallett 24 league goals, Knight 7. Come on, Keith.
You only include friendly. Come on, Keith. You only include friendly.
Horsham 0, Herne Bay 2.
It's only 7 votes.
Horsham 0, Herne Bay 2.
Good. Oh, Pullman's got 2. He's been around for years, I've known him.
Thanks, Adam Flanagan, for that stat.
Hive Town 2, Carr Shorten Athletic 2.
About right result, isn't it, for both of them.
Moseley 3, Guernsey 1.
Guernsey puts them in a bit of...
Yeah, it does.
Wouldn't the league like to see him go though? They wouldn't?
No.
Okay. You have to fly to Guernsey at night before to play in the obviously Guernsey.
On the day.
But you can choose to go night before.
Unless you want to pay.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying.
So you fly out, play, fly back.
You don't have a night out there, it's terrible.
And you're saying teams want them in the league still?
Yeah. Some do.
Sure, we flew out a couple of times. Yeah, that's it.
South Park 2, Faversham Town 1.
Again, it's a good result because they've got Amateur Borough and they're playing tonight as well. And they've got their 4 games in a week. And
they're the dark horses.
Depends on their South Park.
Yeah, they're playing Saturday, playing tonight, playing Wednesday.
Yeah, I won that cup.
Welcome to Nolly Football.
Catch up and
go. 4-5-1.
Oh, that was a cracking game, wasn't it? 5-4. They played. We knew they played South Park a few weeks ago in the cup.
Once I played 2 on Saturday as well.
Yeah, double banker.
Yeah.
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 Three Bridges 0, Ramsgate 2.
It's a good result for Ramsgate. Obviously, Three Bridges need the points, but.
They seem to lose every time Guernsey lose. They seem to lose.
Well, Ante called everything wrong last week. Sorry, Ante, if you're listening, because he thought they'd win. Obviously, Greenwich Borough.
And then, of course, we go to this one. Walton Casuals 1, Chatham Town 2.
Well, he said about Chatham and my mate, but yeah.
Because he mentioned Chatham.
He's right, but everyone that's been on this show has lost the next game. That's what we're saying. You don't want to be...
Not everybody. Right, what are we coming in?
Yeah. I told you I didn't want to come.
Tommy asked us, could we send you in?
He keeps going in.
He's asked me, can you be bigger than Ricky? It don't work for me either, that's why we keep losing. But no, what a result that was for Chatham. They needed it. It's gave them some hope. You know, they've got a game in hand over Guernsey that will only bring it to 4 points. Mm. So
the bottom of the table then, he's got them in 24. Played 39 with 18 points. Three Bridges played 38 with 25. Chatham played 38 with 26. Guernsey have played 39 with 33. Chipstead have played 39 with 34. Moseley have played 37 with 36. And then there's a big jump then to East Grinstead have played 38 with 43. At the top is Tooting Mitcham United have played 39 with 92. Dorking have played 38 with 83. Greenwich have played 38 with 75. Crimpton Casuals have played 38 with 72. Carr Shorten have played 39 with 68. And then you've got three teams on 67. Hastings, Hive and Lewis. And then you go, Faversham are on 60. Alton Casuals on 60. South Park on 57. But have got seven games in hand on Carr Shorten Athletic.
Too many though. Too many. They've played so many because they had the FA Trophy run where they got knocked out at Tranmere, didn't they? Mm. They've had a couple of games called off, but they won't make it up. It's impossible. We know we see the back going on the run, but they lost in another one Saturday.
Well, put it this way, if they do get in there, they'll be famous for it.
They will, but
because of their momentum.
I called it ages ago with Hastings, and
I want Hastings,
they've got themselves there now with the game in hand, and I think if they get in the playoffs, then I know Borough and all that must be in it, but that's going to be some couple of great playoff games.
I mean, there's two teams there. Got Hastings has played 38, 105 goals. Tooting and Mission United have played 39 with 113 goals. And then you look at the other end, Godalming have played 39, conceded 116. And Chatham have played 38, conceded 102.
How many goals have they had?
And the screens did have conceded 98, and the keeper was under.
But they probably scored, I bet it's quite not far off,
72.
Yeah, there you go. Yeah. I know they score a lot.
So then, Tommy, for you then, team of the week?
For me, team of the week, yeah. God on me.
Yeah.
Me too.
Yes, it was God on me, Carr Shorten, Enfield Town and Brentwood were the four that Craig went for.
They deserve it just by keeping a clean sheet, as they've let in 116 goals.
The bottom of the league, to get them even up for keeping a clean sheet and winning a game, is they've won it
They won't win it, but... because people vote for the others,
I mean, Crimpton's were winning by about 4% of the vote, I think, last time I looked, about an hour or so ago, but...
So come on, vote for Godalming.
Yeah, see what happens. See if we can get them in there. They were winning all week, and then all of a sudden the Brazilian fans got on there and decided that they wanted groupings to win it. So I suppose, should we start with, with Billy Ricky? We go a bit early with Billy Ricky. We've got through those results pretty quickly tonight. So, I mean, I suppose the one thing for me, the biggest question, and I suppose what's name in the room, I suppose, is Glenn's come, you're coming, Glenn, everything's going on. For me, I suppose the one main question, do you actually... Are you getting a little bit cheesed off now with the fact wherever you seem to look, if it's Twitter, if it's Facebook, if it's the press or wherever it is, there's somebody in there making some kind of comment or a negative comment about you going into Billericay?
I was at first, and at first I was replying to it because I don't have any social media. I've never had any social media. So at first I was replying and I was definitely replying in the wrong way. I was getting very angry, and but now it doesn't faze me at all. So now I just think, do you know what? The fact that we're talked about, it's great. Mm. And I look at anything, and I was talking to Mark Wright would come over on Saturday. He said, Glenn, I'd have 2 million people say this show's great and 2 million say it's rubbish. Mm. So I'm now at the stage where I just concentrate on my fans and Billy Ricky fans and the good stuff that they say and the support that they give. So these people don't faze me anymore. Mm. I've learned in 4 months just to ignore them and not even react. So if they get rude, I block them. Mm. If they don't, I leave them on there. But they don't faze me anymore, no.
What made you go into Billy Ricky?
Well, I'll be honest with you, I was looking at Dagmar Edwards.
Yeah.
I was looking at Bishop Stortford first. And then it worked out that the Luigi only had 57% share, so I had to pull out of that. I went to go for Dagmar Redbridge. Whatever reasons there was that I can't really divulge the reasons that there was, but in the end I didn't get Dagmar Redbridge. But I got to a stage with Dagmar Redbridge where the fans, how can I say it in the right way, the fans wasn't supportive. That bothered me a lot. The things were being said about me and my family for the Dagmar Redbridge fans, that did bother me. Mm. So I think I would have walked away from Dagmar Redbridge because the way I was treated anyway. And I was always, should. I mean, I was going over there for a fans forum and taking security with me. It's madness. I don't remember one fan shaking my hand and saying hello. I got over Billy Ricky, I got him asking to take a picture of me. The other day they asked for some pictures. I said, what, of Paul? I said, no, you. It's great. It's great.
So obviously we take a picture.
So the reason I went to Billy Ricky in the end was it was a club that was for sale that had, because I had to have a club that could grow. Mm-hmm.
Yep.
There's no point in me having a club that can't grow. Because I'm a, if I do say I'm obsessed with it, I'm OCD, I'm an addict in every way, and whatever I do, I have to achieve the best. So it was the only club I could find that had growing potential. And that's how I ended up with it.
What happened, what did you think when you first walked in the door?
Well, I'll tell you what I thought. If I buy a business, or I buy, if I buy a business, if I go in there and everything's right, I can't improve that business. Mm-hmm. So for me to go in there and there's quite a lot that needs doing, being polite,
yep.
I was pleased about that, because if the change rooms are wrong, if the clubhouse is wrong, if the supporters are wrong, if the communication is wrong, it's quite easy to fix. So if I'm going to buy a business, I want loads to be wrong, because that means I can improve it.
Yeah.
So I'm pleased it was the way it was, because well, you can see what we've already discussed in 4 months.
Yeah.
200 to 800 people.
Mm. We had, obviously, Craig in last week, which you and yes. I, and to be fair to him, he did say that you had made a major difference in yeah. the club, the things, even with the kids' stuff being put on the walls and things like that. He yeah. was very complimentary about that.
Yeah.
And he did say the difference you had made.
I mean, I was there when I left in the summer.
Yeah.
After I went back, I was there best part 3.5 years. And the club, I mean, you probably know, was divided. How have you got everyone back in one sort of unit?
Well, the club, what it is for me is the... I'm a born again Christian, and I believe that love is mightier than the sword. And the only way I've got everybody back is we've had the club for them, and I've asked them what their problems was. I've asked them what their beef was, and they've all told me. So I've fixed what their problems was. And what I have to do is I have to do everything I say I'm going to do, whether it's with the players, whether it's with the fans, whether it's with the staff, whether it's with the club, whether it's with the ground. I have to do everything I say I'm going to do, I have to do. So all I've done is walk to the walk, and they've slowly started coming back. It's that simple, really.
Yeah, because I know those boycotting games, home games, the last couple of years. And I mean, when we won the league over there, there was like 1,300 there, and it was buzzing. The place is buzzing. I feel that's coming back, which is great to see, because they are good people over there. Yeah. Not just the supporters, but obviously like Ron and Joyce, people like that are great people. So fair play.
It's a great club, and I think if we get in the playoffs, there'll be 2,000 over there. I'm really, don't be wrong, I get a bit excited, but I think there's no end to where this club can go, I really do. So, but all it was about was just uniting everybody and giving everybody what they wanted. It was that simple, really.
Well, yourself, Paul, obviously you've come over, which was a surprise to a lot of people, especially where you played. What did you think when you walked through the door?
Listen, a few days before, obviously spoke to the owner, so I knew how ambitious he was and where he wants to take the football club. So going off what he had to say and to do and wanting to be part of that, it was a no-brainer really, because like you say, I've had a good career. To be fair, I was going to finish playing, hang my boots up and stop playing, but obviously I spoke to Glenn and he gave me an opportunity to be part of this new venture really. Something I'm looking forward to, and I've only been there 10 days,
yeah.
a week, 2 weeks, but it feels like I've been here a year. Like everyone at the club's been fantastic with me, and it's easy when you've got a great bunch of lads.
Have you found the standard?
Yeah, better than I expected, to be fair, and to be fair, we've got some boys that can play. I've only played 3 other teams, so I can't really talk about others, but I think our bunch of boys, we've got a lot of ability there, and hopefully we can prove on Saturday and go on from there.
About you, Bill, obviously you played around in non-league and whatever, and obviously great reputation. Obviously you know Billy Ricky from your Chelmsford days. Was it easy decision for you?
Yeah, I don't think I was playing as much as I probably would have liked at Chelmsford. I think they had quite a big squad there, to be fair, but I'd still scored the goal for game ratio was still decent, and then obviously again come in, and yeah, it was a no-brainer, to be honest. The ambition they showed and the players they said they were going to sign, So yeah, the last few months have been good to least, but also we can kick on now.
Have you found it, I'll say, not difficult, Glenn, getting all these players in? Because obviously, you know, you brought some big experienced players in, and I know Mackay's a little bit different, but you know, with Slane and the keeper and obviously these two, has it been difficult sitting there thinking, what do I need to get us out of this league, or what do I need to take the club forward?
I shouldn't really say this because I could very easily come unstuck, but I'd say what I believe, and then if I get kicked in the teeth, I'll get kicked in the teeth. But I always, when I took this club over, I said from word go, this year was building, next year we're going to win the league. Mm-hmm. That's what I said. But what's happened is we've started getting a few results and we've started getting a little bit excited. And I'm the same, I'm saying to them, come on lads, we're going to win 9 out of 9, we're going to get the playoffs. But I know I have a squad now that can win that league next year. I know I can. Mm. I don't think we can win any of these leagues comfortably because all the standards are too good. But I know we can win that league. So for me, there's three or four players that I'm playing quite a lot of money for that's not getting in the side at the moment. That's frustrating. Mm. But the bigger picture is we've built this team quicker than I thought I would. I believe it's there now. I honestly believe we have the right side. I'm blessed to be manager, and I'm sure we'll get onto that soon. But I'm in that change room, and I see the belief in them. I look in their eyes, and they know they're going to win. They know it. And the two losses we've had recently, I wasn't there on Tuesday. I thought I'd lost a friend, but I wasn't there Tuesday. And the one against Grace, I wasn't in the dugout. But the only two losses we've had is teams that have parked the bus and hit us in the 90th minute. So I believe the playoffs is a tough shout. It's a tough shout. We've got some tough teams. And I'm 50-50 on that, but we're going to go through it with everything. Mm-hmm. But next year, well, it'll quite exciting times if we get next year.
Well, I listened, I was up on the in the press box just afterwards. He was coming out for the, I think it was either he was going in or he was coming out for the coming in for the first half or going out for the second half when he was playing Harlow in the first game. And I remember you turning around, I don't think it was Justin or you spoke to someone, and went, all the teams around us are actually losing, come on, we can do this.
Yeah.
The enthusiasm that came across, it was just like me being, although he was, you know, you're the manager of the team, it was almost as if he was like a supporter of the side as well, because you were so sort of pumped, sort of, I think he was maybe going out in the second half, and you're so pumped that all these other teams around you are actually losing. And you could see that sort of affecting all round your players. You know, straight away, the players are looking up and say, wow, you could see the head sort of raise straight away as you came out for that second half. And do you feel like that as well? Do you feel like you're a supporter as well as the manager?
I feel like I'm a supporter, the manager, not a player. I wish I was a player, but I'm a player. But do you know what? It's just genuine. It's just, I'm just genuinely obsessed with getting this club where it can go. And the nonsense that flies about the amount of money that's being thrown about, it's not even close. There was a ridiculous article in the Sun newspaper today about I'd pay a manager $5,000. The highest paid player is £1,000. I wouldn't go over that, and I'm for nothing. But it's we're not even buying the teams that people think we're buying. We're not. We're a bunch of lads that actually have got enthusiasm, the will to win, the desire to win. And what I'm buying is lads with heart. And for me, I've got the right bunch of lads. I really have. And Justin coming along has helped me on the technical side of things, because I'm good at getting... My jobs and my business are making people believe in themselves. My business is getting 20%, 30% out of people more than maybe they get out of their self, making people do what they couldn't do. That's been my businesses for 20 years, that's what I do. But Justin's coming on the technical side, that's really helped. I feel like I'm everything, yeah. I feel like I'm everything, so let's hope I don't go over with an heart attack.
Well, I heard somebody talking, I'll say I was at Abley at the weekend, and I heard somebody describe Justin, and he's probably absolutely spot on. Absolutely spot on, and they turned around and they went, he's the nicest person on that he's off the pitch, but he's a complete nutter a minute as soon as the whistle blows.
Fair point.
Yeah.
What's
the other point? You said there
were
3 points.
Well,
as you know me. I mean, that's why me and Glenn get on so well. You know what I mean? We want to kick every ball that the players are doing. We want to be on the pitch with them if we could, but we know we're not. We're probably too old or whatever you want to call it. And it's infectious, like Glenn just said. Like, I'm, as you know, I'm in my like previous jobs, I've been quite the one that's motivating, but he's even motivating me, making me enjoy it. You know what I mean? And I've not had that before, where it's always me motivating the whole team, where he's brought a new motivation to the change room. Change room on Saturday was, I've been involved in football 20 years and been in thousands of change rooms, and what we did before he went off, I won't reveal the secrets, but I thought it was bang on, mate. You know what I mean? Like, and he got us real together and different to what I've ever done in a change room. Normally the other way, getting people pumping and getting them firing. He wanted to do the other side of it and relax players. And I thought he was spot on and gave me goose pimples, I'm not going to lie to you. And that's credit to him. And one thing I give him credit for, someone in his position could say, I know it all. He doesn't. He's willing to listen and learn. And that, to me, that's why he's going to achieve what he wants to achieve.
So do you want a career in management?
No. I believe me and Justin can take these boys up to the national conference. Once we got to the national conference, I think I'd have to step down. Justin could stay involved, but I think I'd have to step down and have more of a tactician, someone that's done it before. Mm-hmm. So I think I could certainly get us through the Southern Conference with Justin and the Ryman Prem. But once...
If he tasted that, he won't. I'm telling you, I know him already. If he tasted that, it'd be very hard for him to get.
But for me, there's levels. There's levels where you can and can't go.
Yeah, he's a business.
And I think that would be my level. So I think I could get to it, and that's where I have to go.
But when you get to the conference as well, you're around sides equivalent to yourselves.
Exactly that.
So that is a difference as well. But, you know, what Dave was saying about people having a pop at you and things like that, and I think we've said it's... You want to see non-league clubs try and progress. And if someone like yourselves willing to come and put their own money in, then all well and good.
But if there's
clubs, you need another 72 of you.
You know, obviously the financial backing obviously helps, but there's clubs like Accrington that have not had something to weigh in, you say, that have done it and consolidated. Mm. Obviously the financial backing will help. You know, and I'd love to see them get up there. There's a club I love to bit, so I'd love to see you.
Oh, thank you. It's very kind. Thank you.
So if we go back to you in the management part of it, so all the, 260 must be up to now, different managers that have announced for next season for Villa Ricky, it's complete nonsense and it's going to be yourself?
Well, if the lads want me, it'll be me. It'll be a question that's asked the lads.
Would they say no, because you're paying
them? Well, that's a good point. That's actually a good point.
I know footballers are thick, and don't
you know what? I had this chat with my wife, and my wife said, do they respect you because you're paying them the money? And I don't think they do.
I think you look them in the eyes and see the respect.
I think we all respect each other, and it doesn't have anything to do with money.
No,
I really don't. I think we've all got a bond, and I don't think it's anything to do with money. I really don't.
People say about the money, but you know, what's the difference of what you're doing there and to what a Premiership player's getting? Right. And you know, you've been there. People say that's obscene, but if that's what clubs and that are willing to pay, then that's what they're worth. I think a footballer, and again, Paul's the best one to answer at the level he's playing. Plays football because deep down he wants to play football. Because when we're all 8-year-old kids, that's the one thing you want to do is go with your mate straight out the front door and kick a football around.
Yeah. I mean, I'll say one of the questions that was sent in to Nick for satellite on the Saturday when I spoke to him was, is the Rhino League thinking about bringing in fair play with the money side of it? And someone said there's one club out there, no name was actually mentioned. They're spending this amount of money. Nick did pick up on that and mentioned the club, which wasn't you, it was somebody else. And he just turned around and said, no. He said, we're not going to do that. He said, because how can I go to somebody and say, you can't spend that amount of money? Because if they've got that type of amount of money, then why shouldn't they be allowed to spend it? So
it'll never happen.
Yeah,
never happened, because you have to do it away from the Premier League.
It's not the last. You can look at Margate, you can look at Ebbsfleet.
Great.
Ebbsfleet
are a prime example, aren't they? Man City are a prime example. Let's go right to the top.
I think you need it. Without it,
it's boring.
It's just going to be exciting. For what some people say, and you're still getting it yourselves, but you know, as a manager, you're talking to a player now, and he'll want even more money because he thinks it's around, because Bill and Ricky might be paying that, and they might even come to you and put an extra whatever on because they know you've got money.
Oh, I'm getting
that. You know, so that's the only thing that people sit there and think, oh, it's a snowball effect. But this wasn't just before you could have gone on people said it about Greenwich Borough when we had them in there, and they're saying,
Margate's chairman didn't do one thing to the ground. He done so much to the ground.
There's difference with that. Margate don't own their ground. It's leased by four different
Most sides. Most don't own their ground. Own his ground.
No, but Margate had issues with four different firms owned different ends.
But I'm saying you could have put a new fence around, you could have done the pitch up a little bit, you could have made the bar a bit more presentable, the ballroom.
Yes.
What I'm trying to say is, for someone that you just said he doesn't own the ground, I mean, why would he do it for a flash in the pan?
I think the biggest thing to look at is we only have 7 years left on our lease.
Mm-hmm.
7 years. I put a new clubhouse up, new ground, 3G pitch for training on for local communities. So this ain't all about us just winning games and going up the leagues. This is for the whole community. It's a lot bigger than that. And that's when it frustrates me when people just look at the small term. You've bought your way out of your league. But no, we haven't. We're actually giving a service to the local community. Yeah. That's what we're doing. And I think the fans are seeing that. That's why they're coming over in their numbers, they're in their hundreds, because they can see that.
Yeah, regeneration.
Yeah, that's what I think, yeah.
So when you said like you're getting players already come up to you saying that I want this or want that, who's the man in amongst your sort of management team? Is it Justin that, you know, someone comes up and says that, you know, I'll come and play for them but I want this amount of money? You know, is Justin the man that says to you,
they pretty much come to me direct, to be honest. But I love my I won't say the word, but whenever I start a business, there's a thing called, how can I call it? Let's call it idiot tax. So whenever I start a business, there's a thing called idiot tax. So you pay idiot tax because you're learning the trade.
Mm-hmm.
So whenever I've started a business, I've always been at my ass smacked. Sorry, I shouldn't say that. At my bum smacked. I've always had my bum smacked, always. But it only gets smacked for so long. Then it doesn't get smacked no more.
Mm-hmm.
So in this, I've had it smacked at the beginning with 2, 3, 4 players. Then I learnt, not no more. So now I know what other teams to look at, now I know what other teams are earning. It doesn't happen anymore.
Mm.
It just doesn't happen anymore. And if people are coming to me for X amount, I find out what they was on. But as I say, we're happy with what we've got now anyway. So yeah, at first, some people took some liberties, but not now, because I've learnt.
Mm.
So, and that's how he said, where I'm honest.
Mm.
I'm on this show and I'm honest.
Yeah.
I've had to learn the hard way, but I've learnt now.
Mm.
So it don't happen anymore.
So the goal for when you took over, I mean, what was the goal football-wise?
Well, we had a goal, we had a plan. It was a 7-year plan. And it was build this year, win the league next year. So it was build, win, or build and get promoted.
Mm.
Not necessarily win.
Mm.
So it was basically, we said within 6 years, we'd be in the National Conference stroke Division 2. That was the plan. So if we get in the playoffs, we're a year ahead of schedule. If we don't, we're on schedule. So as long as we do the business next season, obviously.
But I mean, looking at the table, I know we said, you know, you've got teams around you like Dulwich and Leeson that played less games, but if you take them out of the equation, you look at that and you've got a game in hand on Wingate and only 6 behind.
Well, if you look at the terrible run we had when you first come in.
Yeah.
When Bill first came in, when Bill first came in and we didn't have the players and we was trying to gel some new players together, we must have lost 5 or 6 games on the spin. That's what's cost us. But looking at that, we've still got every chance because the team we've got now. I'm going to see what these guys are made of with Dulwich and Leeston. That's when I'll see what they're made of. But looking at that, if I'm honest, I fancy us.
Mm.
I do fancy us. I fancy us to win 8 out of 8. I actually
Craig said the same last week. He said you'd win them all.
Did he?
Yeah.
Well, that's very kind of him. And
he said he can't see this team losing the game.
No, and I think we'll win 8 out of 8. Because we believe in ourselves, don't we?
Yeah.
We all believe in ourselves.
The players you've got are winners.
Yeah. But you know what? Yeah, they've all got this.
You know what it is? We're all pals as well now. We've got a very tight dressing room now as well. Mm. Everyone's quite pally now, so it's not like when you first took over, no one knew each other.
No, we're friends now.
It was that pre-season.
You take that mentality, didn't you? It's us against everyone else. Everyone's, we had it when we took Greys, it was like the non-league Chelsea.
and your pals were
with you. Anyone else to get that, we're together.
We're together, yeah.
And you're successful.
Yeah. And that's what it's supposed to be. You go out together, you drink together, you socialise together, yeah. Everyone's mates. That's like.
I tell you the best thing, probably what I think happened is Craig put on a night before us got sugar out a few weeks ago. And for me, that was what.
And that went well. Yeah.
It was. Yeah,
but
you know what I mean? I think that
clip
made everyone feel. But what you also find when playing against teams against us, even I know we won 4-0 on Saturday, but there was 11 men behind the ball. They put 11 men behind the ball and it was hard.
But you can't blame them.
No, I disagree with that. Well, no, Keith, as a manager, I would never go to a game to draw.
It depends on who you're personally. Playing. Listen, you're playing Burgess Hill, who are fighting for their lives. That's what I've just said to you.
Well, they won 5-1.
They might have, but they're not going
to win. But Keith, if you step on a football pitch and try not to lose the game, I think it's the wrong mentality. Me personally.
As a player, maybe, but as a team, it's a bit like what they're saying about Man United tonight, going to Chelsea. Some people saying, right, make it difficult. Don't try not to concede and see if but you can take on the break and open them up. Not just stand it.
But see,
the quality you've got, if you're being realistic, the quality you've got, or the quality that you could say, you know, you could put Man City against Burnley. The quality, if they open up, they will get hammered. Better players are better. Because they're better players.
I'm not so
you have to try as a manager to get a result and how to beat them better players. Now it could be hit the like park the bus, go and pick on the right back, it go direct or whatever. Don't let them play, miss their midfield out. You and this is the beauty of management, is to try and beat them side. If you've got a side, yeah, and you're challenging, it's different. But some of the smaller sides are gonna have to do that against you.
Well, I disagree.
You're playing. No, you don't want to do it.
I've come from Avery, mate. Yeah. So we're probably underdogs every week.
But you didn't have a bad side, just.
I know, but that's a hard work. If I was Burgess Hill, I would have broke the game down into three stages. I would have said, first 10, 15 minutes, I'm going to see if Billy Ricky, because the pressure of them have to win, I'll go at them quickly. Mm-hmm. Yeah, if it don't work, then I'll sit back. I'll break the game into three stages.
Just, let's not give any other teams yet.
The way you're saying, I reckon Chapo come in at half time, and he would have gone to his team. We're to play in here.
They're
mostly sitting there.
To be fair, he was very complimentary.
We need to.
Right, now, what Ben just said, I was at the Greys game. Now, I think Greys manager went and watched Billy Ricky the week before because he got his tactics spot.
Greys got his tactics spot.
Right, I'll tell you what he did. He said, we'll sit behind the ball, we'll let Greys come for us, but we can have
it
every single time.
Proper shit night. Sorry.
Yeah, you can say that, but what I'm saying is, they are chances.
Teams will do their own
thing.
And this is what I'm saying. Some of them might sit there and think we need a part of us, but that's what you're going to have to overcome. And you've got the players and you've done it.
Keith, even if I put in the underdog or the favourite, I believe I will beat anyone. That's me. Maybe I'm a madman and I'm crazy, but I'm going to a game thinking I'm going to win. I've never gone into a game thought, might lose, they might get a tongue in. Never. And we probably have sometimes, but I've gone in there positive.
But that's not what I'm saying to you. No manager would go in there and go, I think we're going to get a tonk and we need to park the bus. What I'm saying to you is, teams will sit there and go, right, how do you think we're going to beat Bill or Ricky the way they play? They might go and watch them. They might sit there and go, we've got to frustrate them. We've got to stick it in behind them and keep smashing the ball off, doing the old time-wasting.
They did that, but they did that.
Got to do it.
First half was probably 35 minutes late. 10 minutes wasted.
You look at your team sheet and you're going to go, well, even if three of them have an off game, he's decent. He could score if I open him up. He's going to whip in an unbelievable ball for him to get on the end of. You know, obviously, I know Mackay. He's going to fly around my left. Right, you know, I've got a little sluggish left back or right back, and Mackay's going to beat him for pace by 20 yards. I'm going to make it as deep. I'm going to sit deep. I'm not creating space. This is what I'm saying.
I thought Burgess had the boy there up front. I don't know about you guys. I thought he was decent. He had no service, though.
Hardy.
The boy up front for Burgess Hill, I think he...
Hardy. Both of them, yeah.
With the black boy. When he got the ball, I thought he was decent, mate. I just thought he was starved to
service. They've got some good players. But I'm not saying Billy Ricky, Burgess Hill done that to you. I'm just saying, sides that you're going to play against, I think will naturally do that. They're going to sit back. They do the same at Dulwich.
But them clubs above us, it'd be interesting to see what they do.
What they do to you.
Yeah, exactly. Dulwich will be a game where I think they'll
be Dulwich can't sit back. They are just full of players.
They pop it.
Which is a good player.
But so does Bognor pop it and all that. They're pop it, but they ain't going to want to lose to you. They ain't going to want to. you okay. Get points just because we played for Keith, four, I mean,
the top ones at the top would be Keith, interesting.
Yeah, Keith, Bill was played against Bognor and Glenn was there. Bognor didn't come to sit at your Bognor went past.
Bognor went past.
Yeah, we lost 2-1. Yeah, we had a pen disallowed, I think, in the last minute.
They played football. Bognor will pocket the bat. They're up there. What I'm saying, but some of the ones fighting.
Yeah, look, there's no wrong or right way, is there? The bottom line is getting they a free get point. So,
you know, I don't know what Hendon done to you last week.
Well, Hendon put 11 men by the ball and caught us on the counter attack. A bit like what Gray's done to us.
Yeah.
Well, guys, we've run out of time in the first half. We'll come back to this in a minute. But we've had a few questions come in. I mean, one of them is quite funny from Scott Alderman. He's an Arlo fan. He said, glad he didn't take over Bishop Stalford.
Glad I didn't take over.
Yeah, they're rivals, Harlow.
Yeah, big rivals, and struggling at the bottom of the
table. That's a compliment.
But we'll be back with the second half of the Rama Roundup show in about 5 minutes' time. We're just going to go for the cup break, and then we'll be back with the show in about 5 minutes. Welcome to the second half of the Rama Roundup show. We're back again for the next 45 minutes to an hour left in the show. And of course, with us is the Billericay lads, Justin, Paul, Billy, and of course, Glenn as well. And of course, we've still got with us as well, Keith and Glenn as well. I suppose one of the things we were looking at while we was on the break was, you know, your next or your remaining fixtures. So I know we spoke a little bit about them, but I mean, is there concerns on any of them or none of them or all of them? I mean, we looked at them there. You've got Kingstonian, as we said at the weekend, then Dulwich, Leeston, Enfield Town, Leatherhead, Canvey Island,
Needham,
and finish with Needham. So there's some big old games there as well.
There's some big games. Unfortunately, if you look at our last six games, we tend to lose to the teams lower down the league than we do up the league. So there's no we can't take any game for granted. And we were just talking about it down in the bar. We just got to take it one game at a time. Kingstonian are a very good side. Dulwich are a great footballing side. They're going to pop the ball about. And Leeston beat us 5-1, 4-1, 5-1. So the next four games are four very big games. So we're not taking nothing for granted. Yeah, we know one game at a time. We know that each game's going to be a test. Starting this Saturday.
Guys as well?
Yeah, I was just saying to the downstairs that there's some tough fixtures, but if we beat Dulwich twice, Leeston, and we kick something this Saturday, then for me, deserve to play us winning those four games. So, yeah, I mean, I think that'll take some beating if we do get 12 points out of those four games and not to be there or thereabouts. So, it's in our hands, which is a good thing. Well, I say it's in our hands. In our hands, to only win our eight games, but you just got to take one game at a time. It's going to be tough, but do I believe? Of course I believe. Every time I step on a football pitch with whatever team, I mean, but especially with these boys game as well, I do believe we can win every game, but it's not as easy as that. We've got to apply ourselves. Like Glenn said, when we're playing against the teams that we're supposed to beat, when we normally get unstuck, I don't think motivation is going to be needed to play against Dulwich. I think the boys will be up for that themselves. So it's the teams that we play below us that we've got to be up for it.
Are they the two games you're looking forward to, the Dulwich home and away? I mean, they seem to me to be, always have been for me, seem to be the team that's sort of like the big team, you know, in the Ryman League.
Well, they are. They shouldn't be in the league.
I mean, it's like Paul Billy. I mean, you see, it's not playing against them. I know you play a lot bigger fish than
Dulwich. We're going to play Kingstonian first Saturday. Yeah. We've just got to take one game at a time. So we play Saturday. We have to do what we have to do first. We have to get the 3 points there before we start talking about any other game, really.
Agree with that, Billy?
I was just about to say, I'll take game by game. I've done the running before, won the league before, just game by game. I
don't
even think about the other games after that. Just go Saturday, try and win that, and then
the
Tuesday.
So I mean, looking at the last game, we talked about it before, and it seems to be golden weekends every now and again in the league, where you look at it and you see everybody sort of playing each other. And when we looked at it, I think a few weeks ago, wasn't it? We looked at the last week of the season, and it's a massive sort of golden weekend in the North Division. And then you look at your fixture, the last game of the season, it's Needham Market. Well, that could be for a playoff position coming into the season.
But we're not only beating 6-0 only the other week, and Mark come on and said you were fantastic as football. Maybe a bit of a plus. It'd be a culture shock game there.
Listen, they're good games you look forward to, don't they?
Yeah.
If it means something to it, then I'm all for that.
Mm. No, it's true. Well, what we got left up in the old leagues?
Well, it's
I've said, I'm they've only got to play though one of the top five. So I know you've got people trying to get in the playoff places around you playing.
Yeah.
So for them games, they're like little cup finals as well. They're big, you know. Mm. They are the big 6 points. So it ain't. I know it ain't a bad running. You've got a couple of sides to fight for their life, but I think Canby might be sorted by them anyway. To be fair, second to bottom. No,
that's a derby, isn't it? Yeah, so it's Paul goes out the window. Yeah, Linda tell you that.
And Enfield, because a little bit of history over the last few years of Enfield. I don't know if you know. Yeah. There's a little bit of history. It's always a niggly game. You know what I mean? So, but mate, listen, like you said, you got to play the best teams and win to get promoted in any league, didn't you? So, you know what I mean? They're the games you want to play. Simple as that.
Yeah. I say one of the things that'd be interesting to let everybody out there, you guys know we've got Paul, we've got Billy in here with us. Be interesting, maybe we start with Billy first. I mean, be interesting for people to, you know, listen to you for a bit about your career from when you first started to where you are now. I mean, you know, how did it all start for you? Where did you start? You know, to, what clubs have you been at and so forth?
I was at Tottenham all my youth career up till 16, and I quit for 2 years. Just literally got back into it with my uncle, and he sent me over Leighton just to start playing again. Signed for them, scored a few, and then Billy Ricky signed me. Scored quite a few for them. I must have got about 50, 60 goals, I think, my first 2 seasons there. And then I went to Barnet, didn't work out.
Yeah, no, I was very surprised it didn't work out,
mate. Stimo said about it, signing, and he was just, he was talking about offering a contract there, I think it was in League 2, wasn't it? It didn't work out. I think the compensation that the club were asking for wouldn't work out, whatever it was. Chelsea had quite a good backing at the time, and they ended up buying me. Didn't really work out well where I was. I'd done my ligaments in my ankle, and then ended up signing for Dover for 2 years. Then went on to Ebbsfleet. Lasted about nearly 2 years there. Then obviously went to Maidstone. I only was there briefly though. I couldn't do the travelling with work and that. It's up and down the motorway for 2 or 3 hours a night. It was just a nightmare. But
got promoted, didn't you?
Won the league there. Yeah.
Don't leave that job.
Yeah, got won the league there. Won the Kent Cup with Ebbsfleet and that as well. So won a few things in that. Been top scorer at every club every season I've been. It's obviously for me personally that's good. And then obviously I went back to Chelmsford then. Glenn got us there. And I've scored my, I think I scored the 200th goal the other day as well. So I've got 204 now. So. Yeah, so hopefully a lot of years left to go.
What was it like playing up at Maidstone?
To be honest, it was all right. I think I'd left Ebbsfleet and it weren't really. I didn't particularly want to leave because the club was obviously going places. I didn't really want to leave, but the way the club, like you said, the money doesn't actually mean anything really because, like I said to you downstairs, they went from second in the league, new manager Jamie Day come in, and they went down to ninth.
Yeah.
So, I didn't really.
And he'd done wonders at Welling, and they liked
it. Maybe because he was on a smaller budget with a tight group of players, as opposed to having 27 players who all looked at each other and thought, what's he on? What's he on? And then, no one was really powered.
Different pressure.
Yeah, no one was really. And it was day, and it was training in the days as well, because it was full time, so you saw each other all the time as well. No one was really that click. It weren't the best place to be about. So, no, obviously, Maidstone won the league there, so that was good. But I just genuinely couldn't do the travelling just on my own. There was no one else, all my pals who live in Maidstone, they play for Hastings, Al, Franny, Collins and that. They all live 20 minutes from the ground, so I was just travelling on my own. And then Chelmsford brought me back there, which was 20 minutes from me. And just went on from there, really. So.
Chelmsford, though, I mean, good club to play for?
Yeah, I loved it there, to be honest. I did. I got a really good bond with the fans there. I enjoyed it there. Rod made his captain in the summer. I just think of whether it was. I mean, he signed Sham and Shamiri. He went to Forest Green, so he does pick a forward out every now and then, and just from nowhere really, and they get their move for him. But I just didn't play as much as I'd have liked. I don't think as many probably minutes I'd play. Maybe start and come off after an hour, and ain't really my love to play every minute, as you know.
Glenn, wind him up. Tell him about Saturday.
That was hilarious.
But yeah, so yeah, no, I'm. basically back where I am now. This is where I'd like to say I started my career a little bit, really.
I know you had an emotional pull anyway, didn't you? We spoke before.
Billy Ricky, I was there for 2.5 years when I, and then I left.
Just got that sort of feel about it.
Yeah, that's when you said I was already played for 2.5 years.
If Glenn don't go into management, I can see Glenn watching them.
That new mascot suit you've got for next year.
Okay. Yeah, mascot's probably bigger than me.
We still haven't found anyone to build that yet. So if anyone wants to apply for that, we still haven't found anyone yet.
Joe mentioned that. Contact me on Twitter.
Knock me out.
I didn't knock you out.
No, he knocked me out. I was in Basel Hospital all night.
Did you knock you out?
Yeah.
He didn't know we were pals. And the fans in the clubhouse thought I'd done you on purpose today. And
he's wild,
he?
Wild, mate.
Bang, and just knocked him out.
And that race for about 6 hours. Brilliant.
Well, that was about 4 years ago.
I missed the next week. It was the only game I missed.
Cheers, mate. Brilliant.
Nah, it's good to be back there anyway, yeah.
So, I mean, is it now a case of, you know, you're looking at yourself now, the excitement? I mean, what pulled you? I mean, I know you said there's a little bit of a pull there, but I mean, was you expecting the call from Glenn, or was you surprised to get a call from Glenn? And you know, was it hard for you to sort of come back down sort of one level to come down and play for Billericay?
I don't think so. I didn't really think about it with mates, though. So I couldn't really look at it like that, really. The ambition that he showed to the club. Craig's tried to sign me for the last 4 years anyway. Every summer gives me a call on that, but yeah, obviously it managed to materialise now, and obviously the players and the direction he wanted to take the club in, it was a no-brainer for me, really. And he said he wants me to be part of it for a long period of time, not just for a season to get promoted. He wants me to be here for year on end, so that was a big factor as well.
Paul, yourself? I mean, I know everybody knows around the Premier League. I mean, we'd like to sort of fill everybody in for, you know, your career from start to finish.
How many you got?
I've got about four minutes.
Well, I started at Cholton as a kid. Made my league debut at 16. So I was lucky, really, to play at such a young age. And ended up playing a couple of hundred games at Cholton and left there at 24. But in the meantime, I went to Tottenham on loan for 3 months, which I had a great time there. Like being in London, to be fair, so didn't really want to move. Then left Charlton on a permanent to go to West Ham, which is my boyhood team, so it was a dream come true, really, to go and play for a club that I supported as a kid. Lucky enough to play in a cup final, FA Cup final, but gutted to lose it, but to play an FA Cup final at West Ham, and the new manager coming the year after, he let me go at Charlton, so Alan Kerbyshire. So when he turned up at West Ham, it was curtains closed for me again. So I moved across London to Fulham, which I had another 3.5-4 great years there. Got to Europa Cup final. Played Atletico Madrid in that. Unfortunately lost that one as well. But great experience. And I was lucky enough to go up to Liverpool for a year. Wellington took me to Liverpool to go and play with Gerrard and Torres and Carragher.
Yeah, that must have been hard.
I was going to say that must have been hard to turn that down.
he ain't got to Billericay yet.
Liverpool or Billericay, that's an autobiography.
I've got to ask one question. How good is Steven Gerrard training him? Because I've got to ask you that question. Sorry.
No, I think you can tell how good he is, but playing with him every day is something even I would have dreamt of and was lucky enough to do it. So
is he better than what you thought before you went there? Because
I played against him so many times, but when you're playing with him every day, he does things that you don't expect him to do. When you're playing with good players in training every day, it obviously brings out the best in you, and he's
world class,
been up there for all his career and played with fantastic players. So it was a privilege for me to go up there for a year. And then I signed for Leicester in 2011. And had 4 great years there, won the championship there with them. played over 150 games there as well, so my CV was good at the time. Gutted to go on loan to QPR when obviously they won the title, but what a fantastic achievement they had. Mm-hmm.
But that was the season after.
Yeah, I was still there, but I was on loan at QPR, so great achievement for them. And I was saying to Gil earlier, that's when I think everyone keeps saying about money, but that was a unite group. They're just all together.
Yeah,
and I think that's where they got where they got because of the group, not because what people think they get and what they earn. And then left there, and to be fair, that year I was going to decide to finish playing football, but I waited right to up till August to decide, and Justin Edinburgh took me to Gillingham. That didn't really work out, and like I said to you on the show earlier, I was going to stop 2 weeks ago. So obviously I met Glenn, and the ambition of this guy, of the football club, and what he wants to do with this football club, and obviously the team. I wanted to be part of it, and I'm lucky enough to be asked to be part of it, and be trying to do what obviously the owner wants to do.
How difficult has it been to get out the right routine of training every day, football every day, to nothing and maybe training twice a week in the evening for a couple of hours?
Is he on the legs though?
Well, yeah, but I mean, mentally, you know.
Listen, as a kid, you love football, and I still love it, so if I would have retired to be sitting indoors doing nothing, I would have been doing nothing.
Mm.
I've had this opportunity to go and train twice a week and play, but I still obviously keep myself fit, so.
Have you subsidised the daytime? What do you do in the days now? Like when football, you know you've got to train on a Tuesday night.
Family,
It's only been 10 days, so it's obviously still fresh for me, but I keep myself fit. I go to the gym, do what I have to do, but maybe come next year, it's obviously going to be difficult for me. But
have you got ambitions with the coaching badges?
I obviously want to start doing it, so it gives me a good chance to do it while I'm not doing nothing really all day. So if I can get into that, and that obviously sets my time out as well.
Nice. Well, it's a huge CV if you think about it. And to be fair, it's good to see players like yourself doing what you're doing, because it is so easy just to say
I think one thing we missed out here, and it's a shame.
No, I know where he's going to go on.
He's played for England. Yeah, no one's spoke about it. He's played for England. Don't matter no more.
We was waiting.
Not you, but I'm just saying, like,
we was waiting for that, but. You don't have to tell us about your England caps, but I'm just going to what I was saying, that obviously someone's played the level you have and played for England and still come down to non-league football, where you have got the youngsters coming through the club, it's something for them to look up for. You know, and I know you've got with bills and things like that, but you know, I just think it's a massive testament to yourself as well, because you could have just seized his age, you know what?
Yeah, it's true.
What's the point?
Yeah, but like I say, I love football. I want to play. If I weren't doing nothing, then why?
Yourself could still play, no disrespect, at a better level.
Yeah, but I had it in my head that I was stopping football.
You're going to go again.
I've had 20 years of non-stop, and I just felt in myself I've had enough now. But obviously, this is a new challenge, and a challenge I'm looking forward to, and especially the challenge that goes ahead, like we've spoke about on the show, right?
Yeah.
What Glenn wants to do. What he's got in for the team and his management staff, and I want to be part of that.
Obviously, as a local boy yourself, did you ever take any interest in the non-league scene when you was up there? Did you know much about it, or?
Obviously, I know Billericay, and even when Dagenham was down there, so I'm around this area. Probably more Billericay, obviously, when Justin Edinburgh was there, so he was obviously, when I was at Tottenham, obviously knew of him, and just being around the area, so I obviously knew about the club. Probably nothing like it was, or what it wants to be. And hopefully I'm going to be part of that.
And I remember I heard you talking about the beginning, before we went live and stuff, there was a funny story with you in the FA Cup final. I mean, do you want to tell people about it? I mean,
Justin wants to. it was just in the Cup final. I think we was winning 3-2 at the time, and Gerard was limping around. I don't know how long it was to go, probably 5-10 minutes to go. And I think England was playing a week or two later, so I said to him, you've got to be careful, because you're going to wave your national team and you don't want to be injured.
He said, nah, I'm all right. I've just got a bit of cramp. And the ball comes out and he volleys it in the top corner. Yeah, cheers for that, mate.
But one of the, I know when you played your first game, which was here at Harlow, and there was I don't know if you met him, I dare say you must have done, he was dressed up in all his Charlton stuff and all the rest of it. And he said something along the lines, and I didn't quite catch all of it, but he said to me something along the lines about being the best left back that Charlton have ever had. And something happened, and if it wouldn't have been moved somewhere else or something in position wise, you would have made a superb centre half or something to that effect.
I played at left centre back. Played a few times at left centre back, but more at left back at Charlton. I think someone must have got injured, so we went to a three at the back, and I played in the centre half there.
I know you were saying about the manager and about manager going into West Ham, and he was. To say he was giving him a little bit of a stick over there when he was talking to the old guy.
I remember him in the tunnels with Fred the other day.
Because I know he was all dressed up in his stuff on, didn't he?
Is he all the time?
He's here giving referees stick every week, yeah.
Just going on to that, my favourite topic. Obviously yourself, Bill, and you've played two games here. What do you think of the standard of them? Have you been surprised in the two games?
Who have we got Saturday?
In what way surprised? With the quality of the referees at this level. Have you been surprised how they interact with you, or...?
Can we say no comment?
Yeah.
No, I'm joking. Yeah. No, listen, To be honest with you,
Saturday, Keith, I'm like you, but Saturday was the best free official.
Yeah, to be fair,
best free official of the team.
Then the guy at Hendon wasn't great, was it?
Oh, it's awful.
Sometimes it can be a bit arrogant, really. Do
you find that hard with what? Obviously, you see what footballers get away with a little bit of talking to referees. You can go and talk to them.
If you ask a referee a question, if you're asking someone a question, so the least you expect is just a normal answer. If they just try to be arrogant, then they'll turn. You can't scream at them and swear at them, obviously.
They still don't like you to be even spoken to, so it's hard for players to go and... Even the captain.
Saturday,
if it's in the right manner, I think you should be able to talk to him, yeah.
One question maybe Paul can answer, but obviously in non-league, when you swear at a referee, you get booked, but in the Premier League, we see it on TV that players are swearing at referees. So that I've always found that strange, where they're on the TV, our world can see them swearing, but in non-league, if you want man his dog, you're the referee, book you, you swore.
I agree, totally agree with that.
I don't understand.
No, that's what I was saying, if you've noticed it, and especially in the talking stage, because obviously, you're verbal on the pitch anyway, being the level you played at, and if you can't talk to them, which you can't.
You can't.
I mean, is the standard better in the... In the national South? I don't think so, really,
to be honest. There's not a lot of difference from all the way from the Conference and the Conference South. I don't think there's a lot of difference, to be honest. Mm. I think it's inconsistent, because some other people swear at refs before, nothing. And then I've heard them say something hardly even worth thinking, they book them for it. I think it just depends who you get on the day, to be honest. Like you said, Saturday we have a really good one. You can talk to him. No one's going to swear at him.
Especially the bets, man. He was up and down.
You can have a conversation. I've asked how long to go once. They're just higher. I don't even want to know.
The tip I gave the referee Saturday, I said, listen, you three are the best together. I tell the league to keep you together, because they're a team. Yeah. You know what I mean? Maybe that helped. I don't know if they've done a game before, but three of them were really good together. And that's bearing in mind, we had players come to pitch, but even Bill Moan said, but he's letting elbows go, he's giving free kicks to the opposition. And I'm saying, even bearing all that in mind, I think they're outstanding.
Good. But are you surprised as well? I suppose you guys probably might not see it as much as people sort of behind the scenes, but I think one of the things that I was listening to again in the ballroom up at A-League at the weekend was how far they're actually sending some of these referees and how much they're expecting the clubs to pay out. And I mean, I think Avery had 74 there at the weekend. And I think he was counting the ball boys, he was counting everybody he could count to get the 74. And we were laughing and joking about it, but then I think it was into the hundreds of pounds for the referees, and they all come from the same place, but all driven in different cars.
That's why I said last week that it would be great for the FA to pay for referees and give these smaller clubs a chance. They need the money. take £1 million off the FA Cup budget for the winners who don't need it. For them, then you'll see different referees, you'll see different standards because the assessors will be, they're paying them, not us. Yeah. You know, they work for the FA, not the league. Mm. So why are the football clubs paying them? The FA pay them, even if the FA invoice you twice a year for the referees. Different if they're paying them than what you are, and I think you'll get a better referee because the FA will look into it a little bit more because it's them that are actually paying them.
Well, we had a referee actually.
That's what I said. He's coming.
We had a referee tweeting earlier on, Dan Richardson, and he does sort of watch the show every week, and he's normally asks us his opinion or our opinion if he's doing a Ryman game on what he how we think he's going to go at the weekend, and he's got an absolute undigger at the weekend. He's got Brentwood Town versus Wroxham.
Well, it's a big game for both clubs, but probably more so for Brentwood, because Wroxham probably don't like to comment, but probably dead and buried, aren't they, really? But Brentwood, it's a big game, so can be some big decisions that game, especially some of the tricky players Brentwood have got. I mean, I'm sure he's got some big calls in the penalty box to make on Saturday.
Well, as I said, I've said numerous occasions, I saw the first game at Wroxham and it was absolutely, you know, a dire game I think I've ever seen in my life. But
you picked some bad games, don't
you? You ain't watched many of mine then.
I saw one of yours and that was enough.
Oh, I know, but he was a
player. Yeah, no, it was, you know, the two teams, you can see why the two teams were where they are in the league, do you know what I mean, on that day. But, it's, you know, it's going to be, I think it'll be interesting. I think if Wroxham will get an early goal in it, then maybe it's... it might liven that that game up.
Well, that's sort of coming into the last sort of twist of the season there. So there's some massive games all over, top bottom, for the playoffs. Of, you know, either a rest decision could make it or a bit of nerves and whatever. So it's going to be some interesting results. And like I said, they've got theirs and you've got your one as well at the weekend. So
well, we were saying. I mean, I know. Again, it was a bit of discussion over the weekend around in the South Division, in the Mission there. They're actually, 9 points in front, but Dorking have got a game in hand. And Tooting and Mission's last two games are Dorking and Carshalton Athletic. So they're playing the team in second and the team in fifth last two games.
Right, the League One by then, no?
So, I mean, it's a tough old... I think they've got a real tough, real tough running. I mean, how would you... I mean, a few seasons ago... And I think you involved with it. I think maybe it was there was in the North Division. We had a situation where it was VCD and also Witsum fighting out for the title, and they were fighting out for the title on the last day of the season. But it looked as if I think Witsum were going to do it, and they were down at Chesson with the trophy at Chesson. And of course, then all of a sudden it all changed very, very quickly. And now they get the trophy from Chesson, I think, to possibly the VCD if the VCD were at home. But if you look at some of these games this year, I think some of the committee are going to be spread
everywhere,
quite thinly, because with some of the games that are going to be played, especially in the North Division, and some of the ones that are in this in the Premier Division as well, it's going to be really.
I think it's going down to the wire on nearly in every league for the playoff places and everything. I think you could find, you know, so I'm just looking at some of the fixtures in the. I think the biggest game in the Prem on Saturday is Tunbridge Dulwich. Mm. Massive.
Could do a draw there.
Massive. You know, there's Needham go away to Hendon, Leeston are here, which is quite good. Haven't go away to Grays, so that's massive on both. Bognor at Folkestone.
It's a top one as well. I have seen Sudbury versus Harrow Borough as well.
That's big for Sudbury, yeah. And I think if you look in the north, which is obviously my technology is not that great. It's all no. Right, and the north, you just see there are. Brighton, you see Bury's a big one, mate.
Oh, yeah, Brighton's a good winner.
I mean, yeah, it's a big one, though. It's a big one.
Mm.
But you've got Soham, so...
Yeah, we're just concentrating, like, the boys here, one game at a time. We just want to tour, we're looking for second and third, no, goodness home. You know, we're not right off the league, don't get me wrong, but you've got to be realistic and just say, look, we want a home game in the playoffs, we've got to consolidate in the playoffs and, you know, go from there.
Well, a big one in the south is Chatham-Godalming. That's a huge one if you're at the bottom there. Godalming, obviously, Chatham need to win it. Crimpton have got Hastings. That's big. Well, Tooting have got Walton Casuals. So
that's 116 goals against 102 goals against. So could there be goals in that
one?
Well, I mean, are you surprised, Glenn? I mean, are you surprised from the beginning of the season with Thurrock? I mean, are you surprised that... Brighton C, Morden are up there. Oh, what was your expectation to be?
No. I tipped Brighton C to win it at the start of the season. And I still stand by that, even though we beat them last week, they've still, it was siege mentality, mate. Like I said, they had a bye, the keepers made a few weldies, we defended for our lives. And on another day, they could probably go and win 3-1 because we didn't create too much. But, you know, as Josh said earlier, I still think there's twists and turns in that. But my head still says Brightness at the moment.
So, I mean, guys that have played football, I mean, we've got one side there that's in Soham Town that have actually sort of like dropped like an absolute stone out of nowhere. I mean, have you been involved in teams or been around teams that you've been doing really, really well, say sort of Christmas, up till Christmas time, and then all of a sudden the wheels have come off and it's sort of, you've gone straight, you're struggling, instead of going for promotion, you're always struggling to avoid relegation?
Not really, no. Not that I can think of, no. Not really. Most seasons I've always been trying to either in the plot, like going to graph playoffs really, towards the end of the season, but I can't really feel
it. Paul? No, the other way around, near the bottom to and win games to get.
So, I mean, how did that, I mean, what turned that around then? I mean,
the lads here, everyone's together, but it was like we're all together. I think you take one game at a time, you win one game, you get more confident, you go into the next game thinking if we win this, we get more, a bit more confident. Mm. So, when you're together and there's confidence in the group, then it's like a no lose mentality really. Mm. We can't lose and we won't lose. Mm.
So, I mean, for some situation.
Stop talking about them. We've got Please, can we stop talking about them?
How do they put that right? Because is it a manager? Does a manager then sort of, if they lose one?
Well, to be fair, they lost their managers, Cambridge, didn't they? Mm.
He took five players. He went the last time we played him, and they haven't.
But if you lose one game and you lose another game, are you then tempted to go out and get players in? And then you lose another couple of games and you're trying to get players in again. And
he lost the first one, didn't he?
Does that sort of cause you issues? Do you panic and still trying to get players?
Glenn told me in the break that he's just loaned them 7 players.
Yeah. So they might be all right.
We might have to find a person.
Do managers do that? I mean, do managers, if you're struggling down there, do they sort of, you know, think to yourself, right, we'll get players in and then it goes wrong again?
Well, managers, they got relationships with, you know what I mean? Like me and Keith have worked with each other outside of it and to help each other to improve our team. So if you have a good relationship with manager, you try and help them, won't you? Mm. Same as you expect it back.
Mm. You do. I think there's a borderline though. If you try and help them out by saying if you're in their league to stay up on the detriment of another side, I think you've got to have a bit of respect there. And obviously, I've got a few issues with a couple of sides.
I'm saying that, Keith, if you was down there, second, third, and bottom, I would help you over a couple of those teams. Yeah. And I'd say I was mid table, so.
Yeah, it depends.
It depends on your relationship with the managers, don't you?
Yeah,
I don't have no affiliation to Soham, I don't know anyone down Soham.
No.
So, you know what I'm saying?
No, I do get that as well. But, you know, the transfer deadline's coming up, isn't it? There's 2 weeks to go, isn't there, for the 31st? You can't sign anyone, obviously. You said you were happy with your side. Can you just see it staying now, or would you sit there and think, hold on a minute?
We'd take one more player. I wouldn't say what position that is because that would probably upset the people in that position. Mm. But there's one more player that we both agree we'd take, but that would be in case someone got injured in the position. Mm. One more player we're done.
Yeah, I agree with that. I think we're speaking on after the game on Saturday. Yeah. One, like I said, we're in the same position, but if this player got injured, we've got no cover and we're screwed.
Mm. Yeah.
And that's it really. Everywhere else we've got two players.
So he mostly knows now.
No, he don't, because there's four people that we have played these positions, so he won't know personally, no. But it is important to us, and like I said, we hope that doesn't happen. But like you said, the window shuts 31st. We're 3 points outside of playoffs, and we lose him.
Yeah,
we're fucked.
We were saying that a couple of weeks ago, you know, in the north, the three sides at the top are all signed centre forwards, decent. And we were saying to Thurrock that you're the only club that hasn't. Have you thought about it? And Glenn said, no, we're comfortable and whatever. But them sides are pushed on a little bit. And
we've got Jack in.
I was going to say, we've got at least three or four forwards, three or four people that can play up front.
Some of they all know, but they've all still got Martin Toohey in and things like that.
Listen, Jimmy's my friend, mate, and he loves a forward.
Yeah,
he's always got four top forwards.
But they're not the only one. They've all brought someone in. You know, Billy Hunt's gone
in. They've got Jack Barnes, they've got Charlie, Charlie's still there.
Charlie's still there, got Jack.
I like the boys. Wings.
Ronnie Wynn,
Wim Duffy's quality.
You know, they're all young players, and like I said, in a few years' time, they will be.
Yeah. And you've got Pindy, can always play up there.
Yeah, but, you know, we could have played all five of them on Saturday and we would have gone in. One of them game, you know, you play it, it's like, oh, they scored one.
But is it something that you're looking to do with only a couple of weeks? And not don't just mean a forward. I mean,
I think for
exactly
us,
if you both could have the playoffs coming in, the extra two games.
For us, it's like if one comes in, one has to go. Unfortunately, and like we've got a good, that's the thing. I mean, we've got a good bunch of lads. We all went out Saturday. Yeah. You know, like everyone's disappointed, obviously losing the game. Me in the change room, G'ing them up because they all sit there like that, all young boys, don't say a lot. And we've got a good bunch of lads, so we don't want to rock the boat. Do you know what I mean? We don't want to say, look, you might have to go because everyone's together. And you know, it's football, it winning and losing, it's how you bounce back. And you know, we're capable of going winning eight games, and then again, who knows? But at the minute, I'd say no, to be honest, because I know a few of the boys listen as well. So,
yes. Yeah, bringing one in doesn't mean.
No, but I think, you know, that's probably
it
what.
It also can give you a lift.
It could, yeah, it could, but we're not getting, like you say, you can't go too over the top with a win, like you can't with a defeat, so, you know.
If you believe in what you're doing is right.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? So, Glenn, when you was bringing your players in when you first started, how hard was that for you if you've got people that, you know, how did you sort of keep the morale of the team up and stuff like that? If you've got to bring in a player that you feel is better than the player you've already got, and then you've got to move them on, and then you find another player that's better than him and you move him on. Was that a difficult thing for you to sort of manage, if you know what I mean, with the players you bring into, you got your side that you wanted and that was settled?
Well, what was difficult for me, which is why me and Craig ended up parting company, was players that I brought in, I believe should start and Craig didn't. We can mention people like Ollie Sprague, a prime example. I think he's a fantastic left back. So, it was difficult for me at the beginning, because at the beginning I was bringing players in and Craig's destiny had to be in Craig's hands. So there was players that I would play that Craig didn't want to play. And Craig was more experienced than me at it. So I had to let it go and I had to let it do. And we'll never know to this day whether Craig made the right or wrong decisions. I'll never know. All I know is Craig's, I've got so much time for him, so much respect for him, been in the game 19 years and I'd get in the trenches with him. So, as I say, we'll never know, but all I know in the end was there was players not playing that I believe should be playing. And that's when me and Craig obviously ended up parting company. But at the beginning it was difficult because I thought there were some players that should be playing and they wasn't playing. But obviously now they are playing. So, and equally there's some I bought that I shouldn't have bought, which is what I said to you about the tax that I pay. So it's some I shouldn't have bought. But I really do feel now two or three that we don't need, and with what we've got and one more, I think we've got a fantastic squad. Really do believe in my squad now, really do.
So I mean, away from the first team itself, I mean, how are you growing the club in behind the scenes, shall we say? I mean, are you looking at under 18s, improving them, 21s, the ground, the stadium, or you know, are you trying to improve the whole lot? I mean, I know you spoke briefly about it earlier on, but I know Craig was talking about a wall that you've now got, which has got like all the Billericay youth sides and stuff like that all on that. I mean, are you trying to, you know, get more people involved in the club as well? I know you said you're looking for Glenn when he gives up this year to take your mascot suit, but you know, this sort of stuff. I mean, are you trying to get more people in?
Well, I've got a meeting after this at 9:30 down in Abridge in the Blue Boar with the Billericay Colts, the man that runs Moore Barry. So, how do I see it? The under 21s are about 10 points clear in the league. There's two or three of them that I want to watch with Justin. Justin's running the under 21s. I'm coming to watch them on Thursday because I also believe there's two or three players there good enough to come into our squad that I need to get on contract. So I'm looking at them on Thursday. The Colts side of it, I think we've got 30 Colts teams. That's without the women's teams. The women's teams are winning the national cups. We're very successful at the Colts and the women's. We're very successful. So I want to bring that through. My under 14s, we're top of the league and we're in four cup finals, including the national cup final. We haven't been knocked out of any cup. We've lost one game all season, and that was in the league, but we're still top of the league. So we're very successful at every age level. So for me, youth is our future. Mm. Youth is our future. And if youth's our future, we've got to give the youth a chance. So there might be a stage where the club goes bump, 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 goes forward. Then it might take a step backwards to go forwards again. But it will have to take that step backwards to go forwards again because the youth must get a chance. Mm. We've got youth over, I'm not saying it because this man's sitting here. I've got kids over there going, oh, I want to be Billy Bricknell. That's what I want. Mm. That is what I want. That is why I'm here. Mm. I'm not here to stand on top of something, stand on top of an open top bus with a cup saying we've won this league. I want to win the league, but I want the youth and the kids and the community to be around us. So for me...
Tell him about the boy, Will Putt, what he said to you. Will Putt, what he said, he's been here since 12 years age. Ever been at the club?
Good player, mate.
Will Putt, left back.
Yeah.
Said he's been at the club since
he's been, yeah, and so I've got... So for me, it's the future of the club, the youth. In a straight answer,
I saw it here when we started getting on. When I first started, there was not even a single youth side here at Arlington, and then all of a sudden the 3G pitch has gone down. We're now up to 20 plus teams, a bit like yourself, the ladies teams winning matches all over the shop. And I remember one of the first youth teams we ever had, and they played games before the first team match on the Saturday, and I remember them coming off, and the club captain at the time, I think his name really escapes me at the time.
Huh?
Really? Nah. Played for West Ham. Blewett. Darren Blewett came off.
You forget him.
He came off the pitch, and Darren came off the pitch, and this little lad came up to him, and he just came up to him, and he wanted to sign his football boots. And he's sort of looking as if saying, you know, I'm just somebody that just goes and does work down the road or whatever else. And then somebody else was asking one of the other players to sign this. And the players just weren't physically used to it being like, you know, as they say on the TV, postman and the bricklayer and all this sort of stuff. They weren't actually used to having these kids come up to them and sign the stuff. And you saw Darren go up to the mum and say, look, he wants me to sign his boots, am I right to do it? And stuff like this. But it's great to see that side of it from the youth sides, recognising the players, you know, in the thing. And I think that's what it's like in that big non-league family. It's not just with the big boys. You see it with the kids now, watching and joining these teams that are connected in the Rama League, National League, or wherever it may be. Seeing these players and idolising these players like they possibly do with the likes of, you know, Steven Gerrard, Frank Lampard's of the world. And I think that's fantastic to see that come through. And you've probably got that yours as well.
Well, yeah, we have got that now, beginning as. But I pulled my boy out of an academy because whatever level you look at it, from this youth level up to the top level, youngsters don't get a chance. Mm. They just don't. I'm sure Paul know more than anyone. You go. So for me, this is my... I'm quite a successful businessman. Having the balls to put two or three youth players in the first team, that's a big step. Mm-hmm. That's a big step. That's a big, big step. But that's where I want this club to go. Because I want youngsters to come to this club and go, we've got a chance here.
Small but incredible football players with a massive football brain on them, it's unreal. And they were at Arsenal And I think from reading what he's put on his Twitter bit, that he did a little rant or something. You know, Arsenal sort of let him go, said they were too small. He said he then went down to Spurs and had a look around Spurs and the rest of it. And he said he pulled him out of there straight away because he didn't want him to pass the football. And from reading what I've seen now, I think I'm correct in saying, they've just gone down to Charlton and they've just signed a 2-year deal down at Charlton. And you look at that, exactly what you said, a club that wants to look after the kids. And these two are absolutely phenomenal football players. Look
at and Tottenham and Arsenal come paying 10, 15 million for one of them probably in 10 years.
Yeah, yeah.
Mm. But I think like Glenn's saying, that ambition, what he wants to do here, why not let the young boys come here and play? Play in the first thing, and then you go again.
The year we got promoted, six of my team come through my youth side that I brought through. And they're still playing now.
Mm. That's Hugo Langston, the fact that we've put one in?
No, not that. I actually brought them through myself. They've been at the club since 12 years old. Lee Dawson's, Jack Oppo's, all them all come through.
Players, Lee Dawson.
All come through. And all in the same side. And they had that togetherness, and we didn't have the money to go out and get players in that way. But
I think it's better.
Well, you trusted them.
Because the reason I mentioned about that Will Putt, he said to Will Putt, come and play for Billy Rick for a couple of years and hopefully get to a professional club. He goes, this is my club, I want to take this club to a professional club. I've been here since I'm 12. And he was like, oof.
Yeah, he didn't want to go, didn't he?
He didn't want to go. He said, I want to take this club, this is my club.
He made his debut last game of last season.
And that was just you don't hear non-league players saying things like that.
I mean, not like Ryan and Premier.
Yeah, exactly.
I've got a couple of boys in my revision. I think you know Mark Smith.
Yeah,
Mark Smith.
Yeah, I know Mark. Yeah,
boy Harry plays
with
me.
Yeah.
And they've got no money at all. But there's so many of my boys, and even the 16s playing in the reserves and all that. And you think it could be, yourself watching an Essex senior game and go, like him.
Yeah, absolutely.
And then you're part of it.
Yeah.
And that's the shop window. And that's what, like Paul was saying, there's no one at that academy level that's getting that chance now.
So every top player was a kid. They've had to play something. Yeah. They need to play football to become that top player.
Yeah,
the only sad bit for children, when they do get the opportunity to go to Arsenal, I think it's their parents.
Yeah, absolutely.
They want them to go because
100%.
It's Arsenal, it's Tottenham, it's Chelsea, it's whoever it is.
Have to talk about when they make it work.
Yeah, it's not for the that little kid.
No, you're 100%.
But they're even being taken out of school now. Like
they get one day a week.
They've been taken out of school and getting schooling there now. One day what schooling,
9 years
old. Actually getting schooling.
Suffering their education and release.
It's just for their parents to think, my boy plays, my boy plays.
Yeah.
It's not.
We had a young boy that was in one of the teams that I managed, and he came in and basically his dad came over to help me coach the team. And he said, my boy's been dropped at Spurs. He said he scored this amount of goals, blah, 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 beforehand. He's a good player. So he said, can he come over and join the team? He said, yeah, of course he can. Come over and join the team. And we weren't a special side at all.